Good morning, everybody. How we doing? Everybody doing good? All right, man. Hey, it's good to see everybody here this morning. Good to see you guys jumping online. Man, I know we've got a great service in store for each and every one of us this morning. Man, I'm excited to share. When we get to that point, when I get back up here, excited to share what's going on with AFCC. We had an amazing gathering last weekend down there. We had to go to East Texas, but that's okay. But it's good to be back here with each and every one of you this morning. I'm going to pray for us. If you're a first-time guest, man, hey, thank you for being here. Make yourself at home. If you need something, find a regular, and they'll get you pointed in the right direction. Let's pray, and we're gonna get rolling here. Father, we thank you for the day, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity to come together to worship, God, to come together to fellowship, Father, to open up your Word, God, to spend some time in it, Lord, to study on it, to meditate on it, Lord, to allow your Word to speak to us. Father, we just pray, Lord, that this service, God, everything that takes place during this service, Lord, that it honors you and that it glorifies you. Father, we love you, we praise you, we ask all this in your name. Amen.
to the end. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Free.
you've done for me.
Good morning, everybody. All right, I got some announcements here for you guys. I haven't pre-read these, so here we go. The CWJC and the CMJC, it's a Change for Change campaign. The Christian Women's and Men's Job Crops in Dublin provide hope to local women and men through Bible studies, mentoring, teaching life skills, and job skills training. If you can help with a donation to their ministry, please take a spice bottle. They're located on the tables. Jimmy's raising one up if you can see him. Take one of the spice bottles from any of the offering tables and fill these with change and return them by November 1st. I know that we've had troubles in the past of us not getting them turned in by November 1st. So let's try to get them turned in on time. I know that it's challenging, we get forgetful, but it's going for a good cause. So if we can help them out a little bit by getting those turned in on time, and be a big benefit for them. They're doing great things and God's doing great things. And then we will return those in a return box in the kitchen, okay? So in order to get them back by November 1st, your box will be in the kitchen. Okay, then once again, the second annual Traction for Life, it's on Saturday, October 17th, starts at 10 a.m., set up is at 8 a.m., the hook fee is $20. If you have any other questions or need to get signed up for it, go ahead and talk to Mark. He's got the rest of the info on it. And then one last announcement is the Fields of Faith. There are flyers over there. That's what I was doing at the table this morning. This is for youth group and young adults. Basically, Fields of Faith, I got to go to it last year and help Tracy and them. It is truly an amazing opportunity, and it's a great time for us, for the younger generation to learn not only about God, but get to worship Him. Every year they do a band, and they have a guest speaker come. Last year we did it at the Tarleton, one of the Tarleton practice baseball fields. But this year it's next Wednesday on October 14th. It starts at 7 p.m. It's at the Birdsong Amphitheater in Stephenville City Park. Now, this year, with the way with COVID has been, they're doing a few things different. We do have to have release forms signed saying that we agree to knowing that we may be exposed to COVID at it. So if any of my youth groupers are here this Sunday morning, I would like for you guys to come get a form, because if you don't have one of the forms signed, we won't be able to take you next Wednesday, okay? And the game plan is that we'll all meet here at church on Wednesday night around 5:45, 6 o'clock. We'll get a sack lunch, and we'll load up, and we'll all caravan to it, and then we'll be there by a little after 6:30, because that's when the gates open, then we'll have plenty of time before it starts. So if you don't have one of the forms, come over to the table, we'll get a form, and we'll get you signed up for it. All right. Thank you, Cody.
All the earth rejoice.
your shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down. There's no shadow you won't light up.
I am. y'all pray with me? Lord, thank you for giving us the chance to be here today. I pray that you would open all of our hearts to be receptive to your message. And I pray that everything that happens here today would be for you and from you. I pray for some sense of normalcy. I pray that in you we can realize that everything will be okay. In your son's precious name, amen.
All right. I'll tell you what, guys. We're gonna roll right into the Word, okay? Do you believe? All right. I'm convinced that a few of you do, okay? I'm convinced a few of you do. Now, here's the thing as we go through this, all right? I'm gonna lay my cards out on the table right now, okay? Because here's the thing. The message that God has given me this morning, I ain't gonna lie to you. It's not an easy message, okay? It's not an easy message. Now, here's the other side of this. And I can see by some of your faces, man, you're tired, okay? You're tired. For the last, man, ever since March, with everything that's been going on for some of you, man, you're beat down, you're tired, you're done, you're over it. You don't know whether to go left, whether to go right, because of everything that is going on. Man, I get that. Because, man, I'm going to tell you something, man. I'm there, too. You know, I struggle with all these different things that we should do, that we shouldn't do, that we need to do, that we don't do, and on and on and on and on. Man, I struggle with that. You know, I struggle. Do you do the right thing, or are you doing the wrong thing? And all this because, we get bombarded with so much information, and, man, I get that, okay? Folks, I do. Nobody think that I'm making light of anything there because man, I get it. But with just like the song that was just sang, man, a simple statement. Do you believe? You know, God, I believe. Man, I believe. I believe in spite of all the hell that's going on around us. I believe in spite of all the bull going on around us. God, I believe. Man, I believe, and that's what I'm going to stand on today. And guys, thank y'all so much for playing that and for singing that. You know, the very title of the message today, here it is. Man, it's simplicity, okay? That's the title of this message. You know, and guys, I started with this question right here. How many of you have ever, you know, or have you ever made something more complicated than what it is? Yeah. Anybody? Yeah. Anybody ever done that? Pretty much all of us, haven't we? You know, no matter what it is, man, we've made it complicated, we've made it confusing, and what it boils down to when we really get down to it, what it really boils down to 9 times out of 10, or I'm gonna say 99.9% of the time, is understanding. Okay, it boils down to whether or not we understand what has been asked of us or not. Okay, we get confused. Now, some of you have another problem. Okay, and some of you, you've had this problem since you were a little child. You know, some of you, you know, you make it more complicated because you don't listen. Okay, you ever been accused of that? Yep, man, I know I have. You know, I get accused of that all the time. You didn't hear me when I said this. You're probably right. I didn't. My mind was chasing something else. But guys, you know, here it is. You know, so many times we take the simplest task. We take the simplest thing that's being presented to us, and, man, we make it into a monstrosity. You know, all of a sudden we turn into some college professor that's got his doctorate, and we're gonna try to tell somebody that 2 + 2 = 4, but we want to pull in pi, and we want to pull in the Pythagoras, some of all these theorems and all this other junk, and we complicate the mess out of it, all right? When the fact of the matter remains, 2 + 2 = 4. That's pretty simple, isn't it? Well, guys, in my experience, you know, when we talk about the proverbial, you know, man, church stuff, I have seen so many people struggle, you know, so many times about overcomplicating what God is asking us to do, okay? We're going to get personal here, what he's asking you to do. Guys, it's very, very simple. It's very, very simple. When we look in Matthew's gospel, Matthew 28, beginning in verse 18, it says this. He says, Jesus came and told his disciples. Now listen to this. I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Now listen to verse 19. In verse 19, he tells us, therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I've given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. You see, guys, this conversation that Jesus was having with his disciples, it was not a complicated conversation. He did not make this profound statement that you have to have some type of theological degree to understand what he is saying there. Guys, he gave them a very simple command. And as I translate that, not only is that a simple command given to his disciples, to the apostles who were following him, guys, that same command, if you profess, okay, if you profess, everybody hear me when I say this, if you profess to be a believer in Jesus Christ, if you profess to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, then this same command is directed towards you, and it's a simple command because he tells us to, number one, guys, he tells us to go. He simply tells us to go. Tells us to go, and what does he tell us to do when we go? He tells us to make disciples, not just of the people that we like, not just of the people that look like us, not just of the people that have the same mindset that we have, but he says to go and make disciples of all the nations, okay? Now, when we look at all the nations, that includes a lot of people, doesn't it? All right, come on now. That includes a lot of people. Not only that, he says, man, when you're making disciples of them, you know, man, baptize them. Baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You've never heard me baptize someone up here. I baptize you in Jimmy's name, because I promise you, if I ever did that, there'd be some of you I would not let up. You understand what I'm saying? Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Then he says to teach them. Teach them what? Teach them to obey all the commands he has given us. Now, folks, we can stop right here, because here's the truth. We jack this up so many times. We jack this up and we make it complicated, okay? We make it complicated and we start confusing ourselves and we start asking questions that make absolutely no sense. When in essence, all right, to be obedient to God, to be obedient to Jesus and do what he is calling us to do, you've got to take that first step. And folks, that first step is to go. All right, it's to go. Now here, and I know where some of you are going right now. I know exactly what some of you are thinking. I know what's going through your head. Preacher, God has not called me to be a missionary. Preacher, God has not called me to go to Europe. He hadn't called me to go to China. He hadn't called me to go to Africa. He hadn't called me to go to any third world country. He's called me to live right where I'm living. And you know what? Man, hey, I get that. And that's okay. But you see, here's where we jack it up. Because by that command for us to go, guys, you don't have to go to Africa. Everybody understand that? You don't have to go to Mexico. You don't have to go to California. You don't have to go to Washington, D.C. They need Jesus there, but you might not have to go there. You see, guys, God very well may be calling you to go right down your county road and talk to a neighbor. You understand what I'm saying? That's the word, go. Go, simply go. Now, you know, here's the other side of that. Here's the other side of that. The easiest way, and you know, we can debate the theological backing of this all day long or whatever it is. But guys, I believe the easiest way for us to disciple a new believer, the easiest way that we can go to that neighbor, the easiest way that we can show them the love of Christ, the easiest way that we can show them how to live their life, guys, is when we live it, okay? When we live it. You know that old saying, actions speak louder than words? Everybody know that? All right, you know, if you're, and I'm telling you, I know it right now, God, please forgive me. I know somebody's going to be offended by the time we get to the end of this. I know that already. And that is not my goal. Understand that is not my goal. But some of you are going to be offended by the time we get to the end of this. And if you're offended by the word, that's between you and God, not between you and me. Understand that, okay? But here's where we mess that up so many times. Ooh, Lord, I don't like that neighbor. I don't like them. They're dirty. They're nasty. They stink. Man, they're living in sin. They're having all these parties. They're doing all this funky stuff. Man, they're creepy looking. They don't look like me. They don't act like me. They don't have the same values as me. I don't like them. And if you sit there and say you've never had that thought, you're a bald-faced liar, because every one of us have. All right? Every one of us has. Now, here's the thing. Here's the thing, guys. Here's the thing with this. All right? If we're going to say, God, I'm going to be obedient to you. If we're going to be like Peter, man, I'll die for you and all this sort of stuff. Then, guys, we've got to be willing to go. Because when we're willing to go, that very neighbor, that very friend, that very person, whoever it may be, guys, that very well might be your Nineveh. You understand what I'm saying? Now, herein lies problem number two with this. Because as I say, that neighbor might be your Nineveh, some of you don't have a clue what I am talking about. Some of you don't have a single clue. You have no earthly idea when I say that might be your Nineveh, what I'm talking about. And therein lies the problem. And guys, the problem lies with our lack of biblical knowledge. The problem lies within our ignorance to what God's word says. Okay? That's where the problem lies. Because, you know, if you don't know the significance of Nineveh, if you don't know the significance of that little place, a little place called Nineveh, if you don't know the significance of it, then, guys, I'm going to tell you right now, we've got a lot of ground to cover. Because, you see, we have, you know, to tell you about this, we have this story in the Old Testament. All right, there's a story in the Old Testament. There's actually a whole book in the Old Testament about this. And it's about an individual that God tells him, man, hey, I need you to go over here to these people, okay? And first command, I need you to go, okay? And when you go, you're going to tell them what I'm fixing to tell you to tell them, okay? You're going to tell them that, man, if they don't repent, I'm going to destroy them. Well, you see, this individual, man, he bows his chest up. You know, he flexes, man. He's like, God, I don't like them. I do not like those people. Do not like them. I cannot stand them. Cannot stand them. So, God, I'm going to show you. And what we see through this story is he goes the opposite direction. All right, anybody now, is it clicking where Nineveh is? Anybody know who I'm talking about here? Jonah. You know, guys, we've all read that story since we were little kids, but yet we miss the significance of Nineveh. We miss the significance of what God wanted to do there. We miss the significance of the command to Jonah to go. We miss the significance of what God wanted to do there. Because you see, Jonah will tell you in that book, God, I'm not going to go because, man, if I tell them that, man, you're going to forgive them. And by George, I don't want you to forgive them. God, I don't want you to give them grace. God, I don't want them to be able to go to heaven with me or whatever it may be. You know, but guys, you know, it's one of those things. This ain't about us, all right? This ain't about me. This ain't about you. It wasn't about Jonah. You see, Jonah had one job, didn't he? He had one job, and that sucker messed it up. And when he messed it up, folks, he suffered big time for it. Check it out. Check this out in Jonah 1, verses 1 and 2. Check this out. If you want to turn there, it'll be up on the screens for you. Jonah 1, 1 and 2. The Lord gave this message to Jonah, son of Amittai. Get up and go to the great city of Nineveh. Announce my judgment against it because I have seen how wicked its people are. Folks, do you see the simplicity there once again? The simplicity in the command to get up and go. That's all Jonah had to do. He simply had to get up and go. And guys, if he would have went, then God would have taken care of the rest. You see, God never told him in there, Jonah, you're going to have to go to Nineveh. You're going to have to go over there and you're going to have to win these people over. Jonah, you're going to be the one that's going to have to make a sacrifice to save these people. You know, Jonah, you're going to have to be the one that it's going to be by your blood that these people are going to be changed. You know, God never told Jonah that. All right, you know, Jonah made it into a, some bigger deal than, man, than it was. He simply had to get up, and he simply needed to go. It wasn't up to Jonah to make them repent. It wasn't up to Jonah to save them. He jacked it all up because he made it about him. Later on in there, we see, you know, God tells us there's 120,000 people that lived in Nineveh. 120,000 people. You know, and Jonah getting upset and getting mad because, no, man, I don't like them. You know, let me go back and let me read this to you again. In verse 2, in Jonah 1, verse 2, the last part of it says, I have seen how wicked its people are. God knew how stupid they were being. He knew how wicked they had been acting. He knew how wrong they had been. Jonah wasn't telling God something that God didn't already know. God knew how bad they needed a sinner, and that's why, how they needed a Savior, not a sinner. And that's why God was telling Jonah to go and tell them to repent. Jonah didn't want to do it. And you know what? It didn't work out very well for him, did it? 3 days in the belly of that fish. You want to call it a big fish, you want to call it a whale, it doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. The fact of the matter remains is he spent 3 days and three nights in the belly, in the guts of that big old fish with God. Oh, my goodness, man, can you imagine? You know, God didn't ask him if he liked those people. Guys, God's not asking you if you like your neighbor. You know, he's not asking you if you like that person that lives down the road. You know, he's not asking y'all if y'all like these people over here. You know, he's not asking you that. But, guys, he's simply telling us, he's commanding us, we better be willing to get up and go. You see, the problem within our churches today, and you know, I say churches, but it's also the problem within our country today, the problem with where we're at, with what's going on. Just like Jonah, we have a tendency to make everything about us, okay? We have a tendency to make it about me, okay? You know, poor me. You know, poor me, that offended me. You know, poor me. You know, man, that person hurt my feelings. Man, get over yourself, all right? Get over yourself. You know, we have shown our biblical immaturity, here by the things we have allowed to take place, all right, within our country, all right? You know, when we have got every last one of us in here, we have got the greatest news in the world to share. Do you believe that? Yes. All right, a half of you do. We have the greatest news in the world to share. We have got the cure for everything. Do you understand that? Now, you know what? Yeah, hey, it might not cure that cancer that you're facing. You know, it might not cure that addiction that you're facing in the way that you think it ought to cure it. But guys, I'm going to tell you something right now, and I'm going to go back to our great friend Buck Jones. I'm going to tell you right now, when he left this world, God's word remained true, and when Buck opened his eyes up in heaven, that man was cured and that man was healed from that disease that he had been fighting for so long. You understand? It wasn't done in the way I wanted it done, but guys, it was done in the way God wanted it done. The answer to every problem that any of us will ever have is found in the pages of this book that each and every one of us have. But we show our biblical immaturity from the simple fact that we refuse to use it. Folks, I'm not going to lie to you, man. I'm going to tell you right now. God has given us, He has given us the greatest opportunity. The greatest opportunity that anybody in here this morning, anybody watching online, anybody that's listening on the radio, He has given us the greatest opportunity to share the good news, to share the gospel of Jesus Christ than anybody who has ever walked the face of this earth. Do you understand that? He has given us a platform that you know, so often we viewed it as, oh, my goodness gracious, you're not going to tell us what to do. You're not going to do that. You're not going to do this. But, guys, God has placed the church up here. He's placed us up to be that light in a dark world. And, guys, I'm going to tell you right now, we've got to be willing to embrace it. And when He tells us to go, whether it's down the street, whether it's across the street, no matter where it may be, we've got to be willing to go. Because, see, here's the thing, man. Here's the thing with this. We're more focused right now. We're more focused right now on how an election is going to turn out. You know what? On who's going to be the next president of the United States. We're more focused on that then we are sharing the truth, sharing the truth of the biblical resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We're more worried about how that is going to affect us instead of focusing on what Jesus has already done. We show our biblical immaturity, guys, when we walk away from what the Word says, and when we put our hope in something of this world, some political office of this world. Man, if you don't know, man, let me tell you, there ain't no president going to save you. There is no congressman, there is no senator who will save you, who can forgive you for your sins. It's been tried before, but guys, it will not happen. But the sad part is, in our world today, more people put more faith in what an elected official can do instead of putting that faith in what Jesus Christ has already done. Guys, it boils down to the fact that so many Christians, we get ignorant when it comes to the power that lives within each and every one of us. Now, some of you may be thinking, well, preacher, you're getting a little personal now. You dang right I am. You dang right I am. Because, guys, man, I'm going to tell you right now, some of us, some of you need to be shaken a little bit. Some of you need to spend 3 nights in the belly of that fish, to where all you have to depend upon is God and God alone. To where your focus will be on Him and on nothing else. Now, I told you, man, God didn't give this to me to make you feel good. You say, well, preacher, how do you know we're weak in our Bible knowledge? Well, here's how. Here's how. Everybody remembers what happened in 1973, right? So I know some of the younger kids won't, but if you were born in the 60s, you ought to remember what happened in 1973. In 1973, Roe versus Wade, okay, was enacted, was put into place, okay? Now, I did a little research because, man, this week I was really curious about this. When we look at the United States of America, all right, yeah, and it doesn't matter what research group. The one I focused on was Pew Research, okay? And so I did a search through there and did some reading and did some background check. In the early 70s, according to the research that I found, now check this out. This blew me away. 89% of Americans, that's a lot, isn't it? You think of 89%? 89% of Americans in the early 70s professed to be Christian, okay? Now think 89%. 89% of the people who lived in the United States of America in the early 70s, this would include 1973, professed to be a born-again believer, okay? So my question is, can somebody tell me how in the world a law could get passed legalizing the murder of innocent, unborn babies when 89% of the country profess to be a Christian? How could that type of evil come into our world? Well, guys, it boils down to one thing. We are biblically ignorant. We're biblically ignorant because we don't realize the power that this thing gives us. We don't realize the power that it tells us lives within each and every one of us. Because if 89% of Americans living in 1973 profess to be a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, there is no way in hell that Roe versus Wade should have ever passed. No way. But yet it passed overwhelmingly. And as a result of that, millions upon millions upon millions of unborn innocent babies have been murdered, okay? Have been murdered in the United States of America. And I'll quote the late Paul Powell here. If God does not judge the United States of America, He's going to have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. Folks, you think about that. You think about everything that He has given us. Everything that He has given us. All the blessings, the freedoms that we have in this place to do this right here, the technology that He's given us, the freedom to live our lives and serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We're no different than Capernaum, where Jesus lived. Matthew 11, 23 through 24 said, "And you people of Capernaum, will you be honored in heaven? No, you will go down to the place of the dead. For if the miracles I did for you had been done in wicked Sodom, it would still be here today. I tell you, even Sodom will be better off on Judgment Day than you. Folks, it ain't rocket science. It's not rocket science. The fact of the matter is, guys, the simplicity of the gospel is John 3:16. That for God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son to do what? To die for you. To die for you. So that you could have life. You know, and man, I gotta wrap this up. I want you to see what happened to Jonah. When Jonah got right and when Jonah obeyed. Jonah 3, and I think I've got this in there, Gene. Jonah 3, 3 through 5. This time Jonah obeyed the Lord's command and went to Nineveh, a city so large that it took 3 days to see it all. On the day Jonah entered the city, he shouted to the crowds, 40 days from now, Nineveh will be destroyed. Did you hear the message? Did you hear the message that Jonah got to Nineveh and he's walking the streets? 40 days from now, Nineveh will be destroyed. Now check this out in verse 5, folks, because this is awesome. This is awesome right here. Look what happens. The people of Nineveh believed God's message, and from the greatest to the least, they declared a fast and put on burlap to show their sorrow. What did Jonah have to do? Jonah had to be obedient. He had to get up and he had to go and he had to share what God gave him to share. And that message was a simple message of, hey guys, you better repent, because if you don't repent in 40 days, God's fixing to come wipe you off the face of the earth. And what happened? The people believed the message and they repented. Well, preacher, I don't know what to say. Well, preacher, when I go to that person I don't like, man, I don't know what I need to tell. Well, maybe you start off with, hey, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for being a butthole to you. I'm sorry for not acting like a Christian in front of you. I'm sorry for not living out my faith that I profess to be a Christian. And I'm sorry for holding a grudge against you. Maybe that's a good place for all of us to start. But simply go. Folks, do you believe the power that's in this right here? Thank you. Thank you. You see, it's a simple question. Do you believe what is in this? Hebrews 11, Hebrews 12 tells us that this right here, this book right here, you know what it tells us? It tells us that it's alive, that it's living. It tells us that it is more powerful than a double-edged sword. Folks, do you understand what that says? You know, are you getting that? I mean, is anybody hearing me? Am I by myself? Do you believe that this thing is alive? Yes. Then quit treating it like it's dead. Quit throwing it down over there on your coffee table and say, oh, man, it's just over there. You know, it's gonna weigh that paper down. Quit putting it on your bedstand and say, man, and just leaving it there. You know, gosh almighty, people, pick it up. Read it. Read and allow God to speak to you through it. Because when you allow God to speak to you through his word, guys, then it doesn't become about you. It becomes about the truth. It becomes about the power that he has given each and every one of us through the Holy Spirit. You say, preacher, you look pissed off. You dang right I am. I am. Because, folks, we've got to be better than this. We have got to be better than what's going on out there in our world right now. We can't be more concerned with what's going on in Washington, D.C. than we are with what's going on in our own house. And guys, God's word is alive. It is alive and it is active. Folks, it's not dead. It's never going to change. It's never going to go away. It's put together just like God wanted it to put together. It's filled with amazing stories. It's filled with amazing miracles. Guys, it's filled with some of the most amazing stories that you will ever hear in your life. And I'm telling you, there is not a single one of them that is made up, because it is God's word. It is God's truth. It is God's promise to us. And guys, it is what this world will stand upon if his people, who are called by his name, will be willing to stand up and be obedient and go. Simply go. Do you believe what the word tells you? I don't know about y'all. I don't know. I don't know if you do or not. But I'm going to tell you right now, today and tomorrow and the next day and the next and the next and the next and the next, I choose God. I choose the word. I choose to stand on that. And if that offends somebody, you can go to Higginbotham's, you can go to McCoy's, you can go to Home Depot, I don't care where you go. But you can go get you some lumber and build a bridge and get over it. You understand what I'm saying? The Word of God is what it's about. Are we going to stand on it? Are we going to continue to allow a world to make us shrink back? Cody, come on. Come on, y'all pray with me. Father, I thank you for this day. God, I thank you for this time. God, Lord. We need to be shaken, Father. We need to be shaken. Lord, we don't understand the urgency, God, that it's out there. We don't understand the platform that you have given us. And God, I pray for the ability to communicate it, Lord, in the way that you would have me communicate it. God, I pray, Lord, that there is a hunger. Lord, there is a hunger that begins in our homes, Lord, to take the word. God, to feast on your word. Lord, not to just, look at it as a side note and say, oh, yeah, I know about Jonah and the whale. Father, I know John 3:16. I know Jesus walked on water. I know Moses. I know the Red Sea got parted when Moses was leading the Israelites out. Father, there's so much more. There's so much more. Allow us to embrace the platform that you have given us. And God, allow us to be bold. Allow us to be just as you charged Joshua, to be bold and courageous and take a stand for you. Father, we love you. We praise you. We ask all this in your name. Amen. God bless you guys.
Y'all have a great week.